Mini chapter 98, Jaymi creates Scorpio's soundtrack. Jaymi rises from his seat, paces up and down like a caged beast, then sits back down at the window, onward and deeper into Scorpio. He gazes down at that ring of hairy-trunked palms around the clearing on his left, where his beast's dancing feet can almost be heard twirling through the scratchy grass behind the warmth of the breeze up the canyon. What would be the soundtrack that could live up to this beast's aforementioned visuals, namely the delicate scorpionic beauty, sleek depraved face, sulky mouth, and luscious darkness of obsession that Jaymi has established in him? What sound would most help the dreary ones to hear their own dreariness through starkest comparison with him? The answer to this question is a soundtrack sung not in Scorpio's own lisping snake voice, but in a flat, seductive female one. A voice whose sultriness is so dry, whose unimpressibility so effortless, and whose underground presence so privileged in access and enigmatic in aura as to add up to an icon of quite unreachable cool. This unnamed vocalist radiates a majesty of downbeat ecstasy, carrying the torch of the whole city's underground, burning with her own laconic magic for a single moment right here. And then she fades forever. Synthpop morphs into gothic, and a gloomy glamour slides up and flowers in the knowledge there is something alluring in death, with his princely mien, scythe, and spooky fashion sense. Heralding his imminence, clumps of staghorn fungus push their yellow fingers up between the flagstones of the terrace under Jaymi's bow window. Around the kidney-shaped pool on the terrace, kidneys sprout up, ringed by monster blooms of red rafflesia, the rotting flesh-scented parasitic meat flower. The music grows creepier to keep up with the vegetation. Horror, fat and hungry through the wall of the room, peers in at Jaymi Peak, its sharp little eyes like pinheads. Peering forward and down, he sees the space on the terrace appears enclosed in walls that swell and breathe, yellow-lit and windowless. Steam coils up from the water in the pool, around a bundle of blood wrapped in velvet that hangs in the air, side-lit through the open glass doors from the lounge directly underneath Jaymi's chair. In the corner of the lounge, stubble is breaking slowly through the television screen. The image on the screen is zooming in towards a pair of eyes in place of nipples, each one dripping out an icicle of blood. A chessboard is set up on the glass coffee table nearby. In mid-game, the chess piece is modelled out of raw meat. The mitre on the bishop is a shrew's nose of peering eyes. Beside the board is a contraption of severed shrew's noses, and 100 baboons' noses fill a sack by the table leg. Underneath the table, on the wood-effect laminate, a worm-coloured windpipe lies at an angle to a mangled corpse with babbling heart and twitching bones. In patriotic colour scheme on the dining table, a cheese's interior is traditionally flavoured with blue veins of mould, red arteries of chilli pepper and white bones. For dessert, a bitter jelly has set, like a moat, around the base of a blood-filled sponge cake, while inside a pineapple, kidney-like and intestinal elements are in evidence. As an entree, there's a stew of battered eyelids in a range of bacon and citrus tints around a pale brainstem. All is carefully laid out beneath a hairy ceiling. Scorpio flickers up, smiling out of Jaymi's screen, takes a dainty bow and claps his hands together, whereupon the terrace and the lounge of the house snap back to their normal state, clean and fresh and cool in the starlit night across the hillside. Mini chapter 82, Jaymi incarnates the Platinum Raven. Back at the house on Zeus Drive, alone at the end of the terrace, Jaymi clutches the edge of his seat in a terror of excitement as he watches the Platinum Raven slither and slide out into meat space through the monitor in front of him. She steps down onto the flat stonework and stands there with majestic poise, looking about her. All the transcendence he could create from within him, and his very own response to Bangdead's arts score. He gets to his feet and gazes at her as if at a beautiful ghost. Flaming orange in the bank of dark foliage beside them, the bird of paradise flowers ooze thick sweet sap, as they do all night, drips of nectar spilling down their bulbous orange petal bases, side-lit by the terrace lamps. Of all his five beasts, she is not here for conversation, he's aware, at least not for the kind that tends to be recognized as such. Rather, she looks and breathes a grander, cleaner colloquy above the level of spoken words or personal identities. So it's to this level that Jaymi fires up his hearing and his sight, holding those senses there as lightly as he can, while she binds him into the spell of a story whose beginning is intimate, spoken straight at him through her eyes without words. A woman was once distraught on waking to find that the diamond ring she had placed in a saucer of oatmeal by her bedside as usual, so as to keep the stone clear following the old superstition, had vanished. By and by, she died. 10 years later, while her children were making improvements to the house, they found the ring under the floor around the neck of a mouse's skeleton. Her gaze disengages from Jamie's and swings to the right, coming to rest over his shoulder at the Pacific, as if at a sunset in the past. Strange to say, he cannot remember whether a sliver of the ocean is in fact visible from here. He should surely know. But he's not inclined to turn around and verify this, when instead he can watch, reflected tiny in her eyes, the waves of a sea bulging and shrinking like muscles in the curve of the hydrosphere. Amid the waves, a hole in the ocean opens, an inverse waterspout, and thus she funnels his attention back to when the Tethys Sea was caught between colliding Eurasian and Indian plates and squeezed up into the Himalayan mountains. She gives a gentle shrug. Seas change, after all. For a moment, she closes her eyes like a moon blink. Her pink noise, more than a mane's hum, he reminds himself, resolves to a music of atom and planet. And onward she draws him and flings him out further, through a sound of darkness singing. You're what Saturn's rings enclose, and I'm the rings of Earth, he thinks he hears within her pink noise, in a voice like the twanging of a string 10 meters thick, its other end tethered somewhere in between the stars, and its nearer end tethered on this Zeus Drive terrace where she stands statuesque. Concluding her emergence, she telescopes Jaymi and herself to a height several stars away, flying through a special sky that's all her own, where giant billboards drift in space, her face depicted on them where they billow through the vacuum as ships pass in silence. Her eye on one such billboard gives a slow wink. And there, within this wink, her grandest view tunnels out, fans wide, spans and hovers for an instant. An infinite series of bang, crunch, bang, crunch, destined to be done by the universe forever. And the terror, the enslaving futility and cosmic enormity of this. Underneath the wink on the giant billboard, her lips part with a burst of ultraviolet shadow, mouthing, catch you later. Her eyes close, both up there and down here on this terrace. Jaymi drops his gaze from her face and bows his head. While west of LA, above the highway up the coast, the cables on the pylons crackle in the night sky.